Good. You know, Pastor Jason and Pastor C.O.R.E. have been letting us know that this year our focus is CORE, right? And they've preached on this and they've been talking to us about it, right? So that C standing for connections and the connections that we are making in the body of Christ, working together and being intentional in our relationships. The O is that outreach, right? Getting outside of just the church walls and really being intentional about touching other people's lives and really getting to the work, because that's really what we're called for, right? Y'all not convincing. That's what we call to do, right? It's not just about what I'm doing here at the church, but it's like reaching beyond the walls of the church, right? Because we take the church outside of this building, right? And so I know that I have not necessarily done this as well as I want to this year. I mean, in the past, but that I'm going to, I should say, this year. Okay, how well I'm going to do that this year. Pastor Jason talked to us about being rooted. What was he saying we were rooted in? The Word. I don't know if you have made a commitment this year to be rooted in your Word. If you haven't, it's not too late. Y'all heard me? It's not too late. Get that Bible, get that 1 year, get the app, get whatever you need, and get rooted. Okay? Because we can't go any further than our beliefs and the truth of the Word and what we know. Get rooted. God been telling us, he been talking about being trees planted. Y'all, I'm trying to be the biggest tree there is. I hope you are too. And today, we actually get the honor of learning about what the epicenter is, which is our E. And so I'm going to ask Pastor C.O.R.E. and Pastor Jason a few questions. They're going to kind of help us to understand it hopefully a little bit better by doing this question and answer. So you get to be a part of that, and we get to figure out what this epicenter thing means. Because I know when I heard, I was like, what that mean? How is that us, right? Okay, so I'm going to start with you, Pastor C.O.R.E. Why did you choose the word epicenter to be part of CORE?
Okay, I just want to give a little bit of context with this. When we came up with epicenter, we have been seeking God, Pastor Jason and I. We've been seeking God. We've been sitting quiet and sitting still and dreaming. It's just like, God, what do you want to have happen with the sign of the dove? We have had such a solid foundation. Apostle Harry has laid it down exactly what is needed to happen. And God, what are you calling us to? And so we sat still in the quiet. We sat still, and we tried to discern, God, what are you calling for? And as I started to dream about, God, there's so much that you want to do in all of us. The impact is amazing. The impact is amazing that we are a commuter church. Most of us do not live in Waukegan, and yet you have us planted all over this county. The impact is amazing. You have us in Kenosha, you have us in Lake Villa, you have us in Skokie, Gurnee, you have us all over. God, the impact is amazing. And all of a sudden, I just felt like there was just this explosion that God was saying the impact will happen because of who you are. You are that epicenter. You are the center of where it happens. Wherever you are, there is hope. Wherever you are, there's transformation. Wherever you are, souls are being impacted. If you look at and see, epicenter is normally associated with devastation. Epicenter is normally associated when there's an earthquake that has happened. What has happened is whatever was shaking underneath, they needed to know where was the epicenter of the destruction. My God, I feel that right there. Whatever is going on in the inside of you, it starts to be an impact around you, okay? And so this was not just a call, and I'm going ahead of myself, but this is not just a call that is on a pastor, but this is on every single believer that is in this place. I want to read from you Isaiah 61. Turn there, please, Isaiah 61. Because see, even though we're doing this forum style, you're still going to get the word of God. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Isaiah 61, let's go there. Praise the Lord. Powerful, powerful prophecy the prophet Isaiah. And this is Isaiah 61, and I'm reading from the New American Standard Version. And it says here, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the afflicted. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to captives and freedom to prisoners, to proclaim the favorable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to grant those who mourn in Zion, giving them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a spirit of fainting, so they will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified." Amen. There's so much in that. How many of you know people that are imprisoned? Not just in a physical prison, even in a spiritual prison. How many of you know people that are being afflicted right now? How many of you know the characteristics that are in this Bible? And who is the one that's going to go out to set them free? It's going to be us. It's going to be us. As the Lord God is moving in your heart, you are the center of. You are the center of hope. I want you to just think about it. You are ground zero. As you recognize that there are broken people around you, you are ground zero of hope. People will know that if I just get next to you, I know that I'm going to get a word of the Lord. If I just get next to you, I'm going to be delivered. If I just get next to you, because you know somebody greater. It's not because of you, because if you look at my past, hey, I'm not qualified. But because I said yes to Jesus, Jesus, the anointed one, he's the one that's inside of me. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me. Somebody said anointed me. That was enough to your answer. I don't know if was that okay, because I could go on some more, but
I think he gave my answer too, but that's okay.
I mean, do you have something to add?
Look, I was ready for this, and y'all know I was ready. I was ready.
I was gonna see if it was 2 or 3 minutes before he stood up, but I think I won the pool.
Praise the Lord.
That's actually very encouraging, and it helps, I feel like, to really understand what our purpose is, right? The word tells us hope doesn't disappoint.
Come on.
Right? Like, that's some good stuff. Some good stuff. That means we got to get right, right? So we could actually operate and walk in that so that others can have hope, okay? Pastor Jason. Okay, how is this idea different than what we see in maybe some other churches?
Yeah, and I want to speak to this. I guess I don't want it to sound negative, but I also want it to be real, right? Because in American Christianity, I'll just call it that, okay? And that's not trying to call out specific churches or specific denominations or whatever, but There has become some sort of church culture that seems prevalent in America, and we don't intend for that to be true at the Sign of the Dove, but we have to be careful because it sort of creeps in. And what that is what I'll call an individualistic or consumer mentality in church, where you come to church looking to receive something, right? Now, there are some things you should come to receive, but it's not just about what you can come and get out of church and whether church was good today or not, or whether, you know, they had the nice lights in the fog or whatever, or they had this really cool dinosaur statue in the children's ministry. I mean, those can be good things, but if the limit of your desire to participate in the ministry is primarily based on what you receive, You're not in church the way it's supposed to be. And so what we want to be sure of here at the Sign of the Dove is that we're not setting up ministry where it's just about what I get out of it and how I feel about it and what it does for me. Because that's not the intention of the call. If you read through the scriptures, if you read through Jesus' words, I don't think that's what he said. thou shalt go and enjoy Sunday morning service and feel good and then go have a nice buffet afterwards. I haven't found that scripture. But instead he says, go and make disciples amongst all. And he calls them to Judea and ultimately to Samaria, which, as Pastor Corey mentioned a few weeks ago, is a place that none of them wanted to go. So what we're saying here is, yes, you are the house of hope. Yes, you are a light. And I brought this up in the New Year's Eve service, and I want to mention this because when I thought of the light, it's from Matthew 5:14. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. Yeah. Here's the truth. You can come here and get your battery charged. Okay, get renewed, get refreshed, get energized by worshiping together, by learning about the Word. But the purpose for us is to go out and let the light shine. But if we just keep it here, or we keep it in our house, we're living our lives with a bowl over the light of Jesus that's inside of us. And what good is that? What purpose is that? Or how can that fulfill the purpose that says we are that others would see your good deeds? First of all, that means you got to be doing some good deeds. But the good deeds come from just letting your light shine. Not your going out and showing your perfection. Not going out and showing you've memorized 17 books of the Bible. Not just going out and showing that you can speak in tongues or whatever you want to call us, different spiritual gifts. But going out and let your light shine. Now, I don't want to go too far, but the light is just, it's Jesus in us and us sharing it because he's loved us and we're going to go love others. It's really not that complicated. That's what he says, love God and love your neighbor. But we get caught up because there's a mentality that we don't see ourselves as responsible. So when Deacon Minister CJ mentioned that we're part of the club, this is not, you know, a country club. This is not a social club. This is a club that has at its purpose the mission of demonstrating the love of Christ to a world that doesn't know him. And everyone equally participates in that. Some of us have titles. Some of us have a little bit of different responsibility and authority. But we all share the responsibility of the work. So maybe for some of you this may sound like bad news. Because what we're telling you is if you're part of this club, this church, this ministry, we all share the work. Right. We all share the responsibility to be led by the Spirit. He could speak to you in the back row of the balcony in the same way that he could speak to us up here on stage. It's just as important. It's just as valuable because he's calling us together to be led by his Spirit and to be compassion driven. But we need your gifts. We need your work. And so all of that to say, Epicenter is about the fact that all of us carry that responsibility to let our lives shine and to come together and to do the work together. And that may be different than what's being taught in some places, but that's what we believe the Word says, and that's what we believe we're called to here.
Amen. Amen. That's a lot to take in, right? Like to really think about how are we doing this? How are we being light? How are we spreading hope, right? Pastor Corey, with all of this in mind, I know that it's not necessarily easy, right? Because some of us don't feel like we're qualified. Like, you know, there's a lot of stuff that kind of comes with this responsibility of being an epicenter. And I know that there's probably times that people feel inadequate or things like that. So I kind of want you to speak to why might some believers struggle to see themselves as this epicenter or as an epicenter.
Right. In some ways, you've pretty much answered it because we do feel inadequate at times. We do feel like, I don't know enough. I don't know enough to be this epicenter that you're talking about. In fact, it sounds overwhelming that you're telling me that I'm an epicenter. But see, the thing is, the Lord God chose 12. Turned the world upside down with 12 people who are the lowest, fishermen, tax collectors, just the lowest of the low. He took those 12 and turned the world upside down. My God. And so when you look at it, it's just like these were untrained men. And all it took was a wind. Acts chapter 2. All it took was a wind of the Spirit to come in and baptize them. And they got baptized, and all of a sudden, they started moving with power and authority. And they said, these men must be drunk because of how they are moving. They must be filled with something. And they began to hear the gospel in their language. These untrained men. So this is not about how much you know as much as it is, come on. It's not how much you know. It's who you know. We're not talking about religiosity, but we're talking about a relationship. That's the who. Who do you know? I know Jesus. I know him to be a way maker. I know him to be a healer. I know him to be a provider. I know him to show up. And so the simple answer is show up. As God is moving, the simple answer, show up. Be the center of hope. Walk out of your house ready to be the center of hope. Walk out of your house ready to see, God, where are you moving? Because I'm partnered with you. See, sometimes what happens is because we don't have a strong association, we feel we're inadequate. We feel we're inadequate when we're not connected. I'm not connected to the source today, so I don't feel like I have anything I can give. But see, that's why we're in the church house today, so that you can get recharged, so that you can reconnect. And I'm going to tell you something. It's hard trying to reconnect by yourself. Oh, let's deal with this. Let's deal with this. When we're doing it by ourselves, we set the rules. We set the agenda. See, when we set it, that means that I can do it this much and then I can just drop off. Because there's no accountability if it's me by myself. But I need you to keep me accountable. I need you to help give me a call and say, Pastor Core, are you on today? We need one another so that we can stay in that connection, because life's issues will cause you to separate. Somebody talk to me. There's enough life issues going on that it causes us, and the devil knows it. If I could just keep you separated, if I could just isolate you away from the club, if I could just isolate you from the tribe, then I can devour you. Somebody testify. I can devour you. Then your faith is going to start to wane because you're by yourself. My God. We need one another, so that we can stay connected. And when we're staying connected, now we have the ability to be the epicenter of hope. Because somebody came and turned on my lamp. Come on. Somebody came to help me brush off the dust from, you know how it gets dusty? Some of y'all that didn't do the thorough cleaning, and there's dust all over the light bulb. Come on. And all of a sudden, it's brighter in the house because you removed the dust. Some of y'all, we need help. We need to help one another and dust each other's lamps off. And I don't care how long you've been in church, because even if you just got saved, you can turn the world upside down. Somebody that say yes to Jesus, you can turn the world upside down. Because Jesus will bring that transformation in your life, and people are going to start to wonder, why are you so different? And it's not going to be because of rules. It's going to be because of relationship. There's somebody that I have found, and it's a new lover in my life. A new lover in my life. My affections have changed because of this man named Jesus. So therefore, I'm qualified. I'm able just because of this man named Jesus. There's so much more we can say, but I'm going to sit down.
Amen. Amen. Well, thank you, Pastor Corey. Pastor Jason, how can we bring this here, right? So what can this look like at SOD if we actually all live this way?
Yeah, which is a powerful question, right? Just to even ask that question. And I don't think we, just to begin with, I don't even think we ask that or dream about that enough, right? That if each of us during the week or daily, if we were sitting and praying, God, what could it look like if me and my brothers and sisters in this congregation, in this ministry, or in my, you know, in my circle of friends that are trying to follow you, what could that look like, right? And so part of this is that I think it begins with a sparking of that, what some have called like that spiritual imagination, right, where we're dreaming before God and we're seeking him. Because more than anything, it begins with being led by the Spirit. So we use this phrase, right, Spirit-led and compassion-driven. And some of you probably heard it so many times you don't even think about it anymore. But don't forget how powerful that is. Like, it has to be Spirit-led. Whatever God wants us to do, whatever he's calling us to do, whether that's big picture 50 years from now or that's 5 minutes from now when you, well, you're not leaving in 5 minutes, but almost. When you walk out of here, it's all, God, what are you doing, and how do you want me to participate in that, right? And so I could give you a list of the, you know, 24 best programs and ministries and departments that we have in the Silent Dove Ministries and those in the community. I'm not going to give you that. Now, those are some good things and those are some good work, but what I'm going to tell you what it looks like is it starts with that question. God, show me through your Spirit, what are you doing and what do you want me to participate in? And it could be different things. It's all going to be rooted around the same things: his word, the truth, the gospel, the principles of loving God and love your neighbors. So if you get something too crazy, then maybe you weren't hearing from the Spirit. But if it aligns with the word, there's a prompting. So for some of you, that may mean, I need to ask my neighbors over for dinner. It may be just a small step like that. For some of you, it may mean, I need to start that business he's been calling me to, or start that mentoring program that he's been calling me to, or I need to leave that job because I've been working 80 hours and I'm really just doing it for the money, not for the kingdom. I don't know what it is.
Oh.
But you've got to ask God and open, like, what are you calling me to? Because I know in the end, I don't know exactly what it looks like, but I know it looks like all of our light shining. And that's brighter when it's 100 or 200 of us out around this large area and around the world that he's called us to than just a handful of us. And so, God, what is your Spirit leading us to? And being open to that and realizing that, like we said earlier, like, I share in this call. I share in this responsibility. Every believer, in a way, is a missionary. Now, we've tainted that word to think it means you got to go to some third world country and act like you know everything and you got it all together. That's not what it means. We all carry the mission of sharing the gospel and living it in word and in truth and in love. So if we see ourselves as God's missionary, then we're going to be committed to following the mission that he's given us. Some of you in here are military, have military background. You know, it's like the orders come down, the chain of command. When God gives you this, you follow, right? That's, in this case, though, it's rooted in his love and his grace and his mercy, not just he told you to. But it's that responsibility that we have to carry that starts with seeing yourself as a missionary and being led by the Spirit and then taking all we've talked about, being rooted in his word and carrying that heart that God has and being supported by others, and then we go out and do it. So we're not trying to be what some refer to as the attractive church. We're not trying to just, you know, make everything so cool and beautiful in here and fun that everybody in the street's just going to flock in. I mean, if they do, that's awesome. But the way we believe God has called us to influence and to be a part of his kingdom is for all of you to go out, to be that light, to show. So whether that's Waukegan, Racine, Gurnee, Wakanda, wherever you are, wherever you work, wherever you go to school, that we're out there living it. And then, yeah, maybe people do decide to come here because they want to be a part of this. And wherever they live and whatever they look like, we accept them, we love them, they're part of this family. But it's not just, you know, well, I hope we can get, you know, 5 new visitors to come to church today and then maybe we can spread the gospel. No, that work's happening every other day. And then we're trying to encourage you and equip you and strengthen you. And we stay unified and we support each other. And we got people gathering in some homes on this day and another home on that day. And people are calling and texting each other on that night when they're struggling and they're stressed. And all these relationships, all these connections lead to influence for the kingdom. I know it probably feels a little repetitive now, but I hope that answered that question.
Yeah, amen.
Can I go ahead and add to this? Yeah. And so even with what he says, The power of God is going to be seen in your unity. The people are going to experience God because of what you do. When you gather together, when you are people of God that say, hey, I'm checking on you. If you show up at somebody's house and you're showing the love, people are going to look into that and they are going to be attracted to that. They're going to be attracted to the fact that what are you doing bringing dinner? Why are they bringing dinner to your house? There's an attraction that happens because love is being shown. It's different than what social organizations do. This becomes relational. And people are going to see that. And I want every young person in here to understand that this applies to you especially. It cannot be just the mundane of life. That I just go to school. Let me tell you something. If you know Jesus and you end up and you go to school, the people around you are going to be impacted. Their lives are going to be impacted. I know young people right now that are living for God, and people are coming to them and say, I don't know why I find you so easy to talk to. You know, I just want to be around you because you're just so easy to talk to. You're always listening. There's impact that God would even use you in. And so don't think that this is not for you. This is especially for you. And I'm going to give you a practical example in what happened in my life as you were talking about the Spirit. In 2019, this is the end of 2019, I was watching a prophetic minister, and he was saying that God is going to be doing something powerful in 2020. He's going to be taking the gospel from the pulpit and bringing it to the living room. Notice the year, end of 2019, going into 2020. He said that there was going to be a move that was going to happen. He didn't know what it was, but he said there's going to be a move that was going to happen that is going to bring the gospel from the pulpit into the living room. That there were things that were going to be happening in the living room. There were going to be new conversations that were going to be happening that were going to be close. Then he also said, God is going to open up doors for you to sit at the tables, to be making decisions, to be a part of those decisions. And I'm sitting here listening to this, and my heart is being stirred. I'm like, God, you're going to do something in 2020. It's going to be amazing. You're going to do something. God, I want to be available. God, help me. Help me to understand. Boom, pandemic hits. Everything is shut down. Church is shut down. What happens with the gospel? It starts moving into the living room. I get a phone call that says, hey, we want to invite you to come and be a part of something in the community. We want you to have a voice at the table. None of this stuff I made happen. But God's Spirit was moving, and I said, yes. God, what are you doing? He wants to take his people and bring influence. He wants to take his people and bring light into darkness. The committee that I sit on right now, it's amazing how God is giving me wisdom to drop at this table. Because I'm like, I'm the most insignificant person here. I don't have all these degrees and different things like that. But God is saying, you're the one, though. Let me leave you with this scripture here. 1 Peter 2:9. You all know this. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, so that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who has called you out of darkness and into his marvelous light. Somebody say, I'm chosen. Say it again, I'm chosen. I need you to say it one more time, I'm chosen. So I don't care what mess you got going on in your life right now. I don't care if stuff is so turned upside down. If you said yes to Jesus, you are chosen. The epicenter starts with you.
Amen. I just like how everything from the connections to the outreach to being rooted all ends up with this epicenter, right? Like it's all part of it. So understanding, right? They were talking, giving us an illustration in the beginning of this about how our core is really what stabilizes us and what keeps us, right? In our natural bodies. So it's the same in our spiritual bodies. So it's going to be naturally going to be happening. You're going to naturally be an epicenter if your core is actually being worked out like it's supposed to. The connections are happening. The outreach is happening, right? If I'm being rooted in the word, all these things, like I'm going to naturally be an epicenter because my core works and I'm working it out. So I'm going to tell you, get your core right. Do your sit-ups. Do your planks. Do your burpees. I see a lot of people saying, shaking their head. No, I don't want them burpees. Right?
In a spirit.
Right. But we have to exercise it. God made it very clear this year that it's not just about praying about things. He wants us to take action. He's making it clear, y'all. And he's showing up. Right? It's more than I'm just praying about it. It's like, okay, God, I'm praying about this depression, but I'm actually doing something. I'm talking to somebody. I'm sending a text message. I'm actually getting into my word and studying it and understanding what you're saying about my mind and how it can be renewed every day. God, I'm doing these things. I'm not just praying about it. So I hope that you are encouraged and that you are excited to do this workout this year. To have your core in place, right? You're gonna have six packs. Don't you want a six pack in the spirit? I want it to manifest in the natural too. Right? So let's do this, you guys. I hope that you are encouraged, that you are excited, that you know you are an epicenter. No matter where you are. If you have said yes, as Pastor Corey said, to Christ, you are an epicenter. Hold on to the hope of Christ. Hold on to his word. Remember his promises. Tell them back to him, right? Help remind yourself. God, you said your word won't return to you void. And if you said it, I believe it. I'm going to walk it out even though I don't see it. Get that core right. Get that core right. If you haven't had connections with people, get connected. It's okay. It's okay. It's like that kid that you'd be like, oh, I missed you so much. And they'd be like, I'm kind of scared to come. And you're excited. It's the prodigal. We're glad you're back. We missed you. Come on. So let's do this. Let's be this epicenter. Get our core right. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Let me just close this time in prayer, then we got a couple things before we dismiss. Father, we lay ourselves before you today. We surrender to you. God, it's clear from the beginning of this service today that you've wanted to remind us about the way you love us, the way you cared for us. God, what you've called us to as your friend, as your son, as your daughter. And all of this we've been talking about, God, is really just a response to you, a response to you loving us in those ways, you desiring for us to be close and to share a personal relationship with you. And God, it's our heart. I pray it is our heart's desire today that everyone here, everyone that's listening, that we would want to respond, that by committing our lives to the things that you've asked of us, to stay connected with one another, to be loving others, to be rooted in your word, and ultimately to be that epicenter, to be that influence, God. And again, we recognize it doesn't come from us. It's not our power. It's not our intellect. It's not our ability to manipulate and navigate this world. God, it's just from you and you strengthening us and you and us surrendering to the Spirit in us and the power that you've given us, Lord, so that your love can flow out of us. Your wisdom can come out of that which we've gained from your word and from your Spirit. God, I love how you set this up for us to have that successful, prosperous, blessed life. All we need is to remain in you and to remain connected and committed to loving and caring for each other. God, it's not complicated, but Lord, we are foolish. We're stubborn. We get stuck in our own ways, and I pray that today you would change us even more. And I pray especially if there's any that have been here and listening or watching online that don't have that relationship with you, I pray that today they would respond and recognize, as we've said, it starts with a yes. I want to know you, Jesus. I want to stop living for myself and live for you, God, and allow us and others to come around them and support those that are feeling that way and are wanting to respond today so that, God, we can work together and we can be a part of this team, this family of God that you have created. So we give you glory and honor today, and we pray that you have been glorified in all that's been shared. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen.